Good morning once again. We are on day 282 of our 365 days of Bible study. We are continuing to look at the Jesus story, which originated in St. Mark's Gospel, and most of which, the vast majority of which, was shared by Matthew and Luke. Today we're on Mark chapter 3, verses 20 to 30, and we see an exchange of accusations and responses between Jesus and those who thought they knew better. Mark chapter 3, 20 to 30. Then Jesus came to a house, and once again, such a crowd gathered there that they couldn't even eat. Some family members heard about it. They came and tried to take him in hand. They were saying he's beside himself. Some scribes from Jerusalem also were saying he's possessed by Beelzebul. He casts demons out in the name of their chief demon. Jesus called them over, and in parables he spoke to them. How can Satan expel Satan? A kingdom that is divided can't stand. And it's impossible for a house divided against itself to stand. If Satan has risen up against himself and is divided, he can't stand. It will be the end of him. Nobody can get into a strong man's house and plunder his property without first tying the strong man up before doing so. So, pay attention when I tell you this. Any sins and blasphemies are forgivable to humans. But someone who blasphemes against the Holy Spirit will never be forgiven, because it is an eternal sin. He said all that because they had said he was possessed by an unclean spirit. Matthew and Luke agree that there is more to this story than Mark gives us. It's not just Jesus returning home to one of the fishermen's houses, but the healing by Jesus of a man whose dumbness had been attributed to demon possession, that caused both some of Jesus's family members and also spies from the religious authorities in Jerusalem to come and take him in hand. Beelzebul, or Beelzebub, is the Old Testament Baal, regarded by Jews as an evil pagan god. Jesus swiftly reduces their accusation to absurdity, and in doing so invites his listeners to come to a different conclusion. Jesus casts out demons by the power of the Holy Spirit, who is stronger than Satan and is capable of binding him up, like the strong man in the parable was bound. This is, of course, not the end of Satan, nor not the end of evil, and not the end of the struggle between evil and goodness, which will, of course, go on as long as there is free will and human autonomy. This battle started with the first humans, or maybe even with our evolutionary ancestors. The death and resurrection of Jesus are a sign and a reassurance to us that there will be a final victory of good over evil, and that victory is won over and over again every time we recognize a fault in ourselves and say sorry and make up for it. At the end, God wipes the score sheet clean. Any kind of bookkeeping mentality should never have become part of Christian morality, which is not about God writing all your little sins down in a ledger and showing it to you when you die. That will not happen unless you insist. When you die, you will be welcomed like the returning prodigal son was, and loved. Christians are about loving God and loving others, about accentuating the positive. The words of Jesus here about the unforgivable sin have scared people down the ages. Well, what if I have, by accident, said something that offends the Holy Spirit? What if in childish bravado I said something against the Holy Spirit I now regret? These will, of course, be forgiven. What will not be forgiven, of course, is what the investigators from Jerusalem have just done. And if they don't change their ways, they will, of course, find themselves condemned. So what is it that they've actually done wrong? What is the nature of blasphemy against the Holy Spirit? It's obvious. It is calling something good evil, calling something wholesome loathsome, calling the work of the Holy Spirit the work of the devil. This is a serious warning to the Jerusalem spies to take a critical look at themselves and consider seriously what it is that they are doing. As for us, we should not be scared of the unforgivable sin. If our judgments are based on loving God and loving our neighbour, we are very unlikely to call good evil. Although there are people around in the world who will try to persuade us along that path, many of them on the internet with their pet conspiracy theories. So don't let your guard down too much. Tomorrow, in the middle of a crowd listening to him, Jesus is interrupted by Mary and her other sons, and he makes it quite clear that his family is much bigger than anyone might have expected. I'll see you tomorrow.